morning, friends. Pujya Gyanvatsal Swami, Gyanvatsal Swami, my managing committee members, my library committee members, invited guests from Swami Narayan, my club members, ladies and gentlemen. I invite Pujya Gyanvatsal Swami and Gyanvatsal Swami to come on the dais. I will request Sri Mohan Bhai Patel to give a floral tribute. I'll request our past president, Mr. Ashok Bhai, to come and give a floral tribute. I will request Deven Bhai to give a floral tribute. I'll request Sri Manan Manek to introduce the Gyanvatsal Swami and Tejovan Swami. Thank you.
A very warm welcome to one and all present here. On behalf of BAPS, I would love to introduce Pujya Gyanvatsal Swami. He is a mechanical engineer by education, and in 1992, he became a saint during the grand inauguration of Akshardham in Gandhinagar. Since then, he was involved and initiated various youth activities in Rajkot, Mumbai, and now in Vadodara. Today, he's going to speak about quality of various things in our lives. And this is a very special topic for us. Like, we would connect to this topic because, you know, in Mumbai, lives are very busy. And we are occupied since morning to evening in various to-do lists, in various projects, and we are busy striking them off. And, you know, we are focused in multitasking while, you know, having our breakfast. We are reading the newspaper, the Economic Times. While coming back on our way, we are finishing our calls. And, you know, most of the times we are busy being doing a lot of things and running behind numbers. A joke comes to my mind that, you know, if you keep running behind numbers and like a famous superstar keeps on running behind the 300 crore number, then tube light is what's going to happen to you. So not taking too much time, since we are, we never get a chance to introspect on the quality of things we do, and we are busy behind focusing on the quantity or quality of our lives, our spirituality, our relationships. I would respect Pujya Gyanvatsal Swami to come over and give us more insight on this topic.
ना चल सर बैठा Oh, doctor. Oh. Doctor, na lidya garu chale.
Gunatito aksharam brahma bhagavan purushottamah. जनो जाननिदं सत्यं मुच्यते भवबंधनात् श्री स्वामी नारायण भगवान की जय अक्षर पुरुषोत्तम महाराज की जय राधा कृष्ण देव की जय सियावर रामचंद्र भगवान की जय प्रमुख स्वामी महाराज की जय महंत स्वामी महाराज की जय प्रमुख स्वामी महाराज शताब्दी महोत्सव की जय
विद प्रोस्ट्रेशंस एट द डिवाइन फीट ऑफ भगवान स्वामी नारायण एंड माय गुरु हरि परम पूज्य प्रमुख स्वामी महाराज एंड परम पूज्य महंत स्वामी महाराज माय हार्टिएस्ट गुड मॉर्निंग नमस्कार And Jai Swami Narayan, to all the guests present today on this very special occasion on the invitation of the Jew Gymkhana Club. And we have met quite often previously. And we'll meet quite often as well. Because we've...
Swamiji has promised November.
And the topic for the talk today, quantity fills, quality fulfills. We live in this age in the 21st century. Actually, once upon a time, there was a discussion somewhere. Like three monkeys were sitting on a coconut tree and they were discussing things as they were said to be. Said one monkey to the other, hey, listen you too, there's a rumor that can't be true, probably that man descended from our noble race. They were sitting on the parapet of the building of a science faculty. And one of the monkey heard a professor talking to his students. Man descended from our noble race. And the second monkey immediately jumped from one branch to another, saying, oh my God, the very idea is a disgust. And the third monkey said, why? And the first monkey explained, that man never descended from our noble race. I'll give you the reasons for it. And he said, what are the reasons? And the first monkey started explaining. He said, man never descended from a noble race. Why? He said, there is not a single monkey who has divorced his wife and starved her babies. No monkey has ever used a club, a knife, or a pistol to take other monkey's life. And here's another thing a monk wants to get out at night and go on a stew. And we have never known a mother monk to leave aside her babies with others to bunk. The list was too long and finally they said, yes, man might have descended the ordinary caste, but brother, not from our noble race. This is the fact of the state of affairs, mentally and emotionally, of the 21st century man. I think we have the best of the education institutes so far in the history of this planet. Yes or no? We have the best infrastructure at present than at any other time in history. Yes or no? And yet our humanity is a diseased one. Mankind is in urgent need. SOS. Of some more morality and spirituality. As Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan used to say, that we have the best of refrigerators, the best of computers, and the best of machinery so far, but the worst of humans. Man has learned to swim like a fish in water, He has learned to fly like a bird in air. But he has not learned to walk like a swan human being upon this earth. So this is the age of guided missiles and misguided man. This is the age of guided missiles and misguided man. Day by day, the crimes are increasing in the society. With the best of the education institutes that we have today in the society that we never had upon this planet before. With the best of the sharing of information and knowledge that we have in the society today that we never had before. The deterioration of human values that we see in the society today in the 21st century is the worst problem that our eyes and mind could accept or expect. As the great American President Lyndon Johnson used to say, mankind is in urgent need of something spiritual, something more moral. Because I tell you, the worst crimes upon this earth are performed by the most educated people. Illiterate people, if they steal, they will steal a few hundred or a few thousand rupees. And literate people with power, if they steal, they can go to 50,000 crores, 1 lakh crores, 1 lakh 50,000 crores. They can do 2G, 3G, 4G, and the coming G's scams. We have run behind quantities. We have forgotten qualities in life. But remember one thing, quantity fills, but you get fulfillment in life only by quality. Running behind quantities in life is living a dog life, donkey life, and a cat life, basically an animal life. They also wake up in the morning, have their morning calls, take care of their families, children. Actually, dogs and cats are more luckier than human beings. They don't have to go out 8 hours a day to earn. I don't think any donkey or any dog or cat has died because of starvation in Mumbai, is it? Yes or no? They never go out to earn, so they're more lucky than us. Wake up in the morning, enjoy, and have a carefree life. That is quantity in life. Imbibing of values in your life. Benching upon virtues in your life. An expression of a quality-filled life is ultimately total fulfillment in life. Because this is a 70 or 80 year game, you need to play well. In cricket, you need to play well in 2020, then in a test match. This is, our game is 80-80. 5-10 plus minus with the grace of God. We need to play it well. And one third of the day you are sleeping. 8 hours of the day you sleep. On an average, at the end of your life, you will be sleeping for 8 hours a day. One third of the day you are sleeping, straight equation, directly proportional, one third of the life you will sleep. So if you live for 70 years upon this earth, 23 years of your life will go in sleep in bed, you don't know whether you exist or not. Whether you are a doctor or a chartered accountant or an engineer or a scientist or a businessman, doesn't count for 23 years of your life. So we need to give a thought to ourselves. How much of quantity? How much of time and energy to be given to quantity in life? Because running behind money can buy you perhaps good beds, but not sleep. Money can buy you food, but not appetite, hunger, and digestion. Money can buy you the best houses, but can't convert it into homes. Money can buy you the best health care, but not health. If there are 1,000 things that money can buy and make you happy, there are 10,000 things that money cannot buy and still you are happier with that. Rather, more happier with it. You need to check out the amount of energy, the amount of time that you give behind quantity in your life and the quality in your life. The most important introspection needed today in this 21st century. If you keep on running behind quantities in life and you miss out on certain qualities, whether it is your workplace, whether it is your family place, or whether it is your entertainment place, you can lose out. Only running behind quantities, you are a sure loser. Let us start with a case study. Just about a few weeks back, the CEO of Uber, he had to put in his papers, Travis Kalanick. At the age of 40, what he achieved is a rare for any startup. He started Uber at the age of 31 and transformed it into a transportation colossus upon this planet. He transformed the basic meaning, the availability, the facility of transport. The valuation of the company today is $69 billion, the highest valued private tech company of the world. Since its inception in 2009, they have raised funds to the amount of like $14 billion, which is perhaps the best well-funded startup of the world. It operates in more than 662 cities and towns in 82 countries of the world. Tremendous achievement for a startup. And it transformed people's thoughts when it came to movement. Now, what happened there? Just a couple of months back, an ex-employee, an engineer, she exposed a typical type of work culture at Uber. This I'm talking according to the newspaper reports. There are cases of discrimination. There was an atmosphere of sexual harassment. There was probably a brush with the law enforcement. There was also a certain harsh give and take with the investors and other people, stakeholders. And from one spark, it was a wildfire. And many skeletons, they came out of the cupboard. More and more. And then the investors, they put pressure on him. He had to resign. He's on the board as a director, but in day-to-day operations, he had to resign. The principal charges today, even the federal government of US, they have an inquiry that probably Uber used a software tool that could sidestep certain law enforcement, which is again a very big charge that probably he might have to face. Quantity was huge for any startup in 8 years, spread out in 662 cities and 82 countries, is something beyond dream coming true. For any startup in 8 years to be valued at $69 billion is something beyond once in a lifetime, something beyond out of the heaven. Quantity, unbelievable. Losing out somewhere on qualities. I started the case study with work culture at your office places. Cases of discrimination, cases of sexual harassment, cases of law enforcement, cases of federal norms violated, many things. Ample quantity is sin. Lesser ones, minute ones, fine ones, quality is sometimes not sin, but is more important. When Enron sinked, Ken Blanchard, the leading management guru, he has written a big book on this, The Rise and Fall of Enron. He said 62% of the success of any professional setup depends upon things that can be seen. Your infrastructure, system, professionalism, work, contracts, goods. 38%. Rest 62% depends upon the qualities at your workplace. We always look towards quantities. We don't look towards qualities. And this particular aspect, very less speakers would like to emphasize on this, that increasing number of sexual harassment cases at the workplace and more heads are rolling down. And I tell you that in the coming years, thousands of top class executives will lose their jobs because of this. It's going to happen. What is being reported in the newspapers is just the tip of the iceberg. More than that is deep inside. It will happen. It is happening at workplaces. According to the newspaper reports, Fanish Murthy, the person who could turn around any IT company from a debt-ridden state to a multi-million dollar profit-making company within a couple of years. And he had done it at a couple of places. He had the knack of it. He was hired by iGate in US, and he turned that company within 1.5 years into a giant software in the Silicon Valley. Unfortunately, he developed relationships with a colleague at the workplace. And according to the US norms, if you start a relationship at your workplace, you need to report it to the top management before your first date. It is a US management law. And this gentleman, nobody, of course, forget him. Nobody would like to report this to the top management. But if you are caught by your WhatsApp, messages, emails, whatever, then you have the hell on your head. And hell fell on his head. He had to lose his job. Nobody was ready to hire him in US. He had to leave the country. And he lost perks, bonuses, and other benefits, including some salaries, to the worth of more than $45 billion. $45 million. Today, with a small startup in Bangalore. Money, work, time and energy behind it is quantity. Discipline and righteousness at your workplace is quality. Quantity will fill, quality will fulfill. You need a proper balance of it. Discipline, norms, and righteousness is your quality life. And you enjoy your life, you sustain well in your life, in a good state of affairs, internally and externally both, only by quality in your life. See, today the notion is, we live in a carefree society. This is a free world. Two words popularly you might be hearing in this society, yes or no? Yeah, this is a free world. I know this is a free world. This is a carefree world. I do what I like. Okay, we are not against it. But this generation, the elder generation, knows a bit better, but the younger generation, especially the millennials, need to be taught this. That you are right, that is a free world, but along with that, this is a bonded world as well. There are two worlds in everybody's life. A free world and a bonded world. Yes or no? Basically, you have three places in life. Your house, your office, and your club. Club is all your sports activities, entertainment activities, your leisure activities, everything included. You have family, work, and leisure. Agree with me? I term it in this terminology. You have house, office, and a club. Your club is your free world. But your house and your office is your bonded world. Right or wrong? So if you give 33, 33, 33, your 66% of life is a bonded world. And how can you say the whole world is like carefree world and is a free world? Recently, at a temple in Vadodara, I was just coming down from the temple after the evening prayers, and a youngster. And he was in his Bermuda shorts, and he was just coming up the temple. I introduced myself to him. I said, "Your good self." He said, "This and this." I said, "I think you are a student." He said, "Yes." "What are you studying?" He was doing his undergrad in management. I said, "Fine." And he was a smart young boy. And then he recognized something from my eyes, and he asked me, "Swamiji, you introduced yourself to me and then you started a conversation. I think that is something in your mind." I said, "Yes." And I felt that he's smart. This generation is. So I said, "Yes." I had the thought in my mind that, see, this is a temple, and you need to be dressed properly. You know, you must be here in full pants. And so I just, very openly, when he asked, I said, he immediately resounded. He said, "There is nothing of this written everywhere. And this is a free world. You might write it down, some instructions here. When you're not written, you can't ask me." I said, "Fine, you are right. I fully agree with you. Now my question to you is, will you be able to wear the same in the board meeting at your corporate place? Can you enter your board meeting at the corporate place in Bermudas? Tell me yes or no." He said, "No." I said, "You wear it, you enter the place, and then if somebody questions, you tell them it was not written outside." It was not written. This is not written outside the boardroom in a corporate place. They don't walk in Bermudas or your shorts. He said, "No, Swamiji, that is understood." I said, "This is my answer. This is understood. Certain norms are not written, but it has to be accepted. This particular incident apart, I was talking of like this millennials and this generation, they live in this free world, which is quantity field. They need to be given the consciousness of the bonded world as well. I can categorically put forward a statement that you enjoy your free world because of your disciplines in the bonded world. Now think over this statement. You enjoy your free world because of your disciplines in the bonded world. The moment you lose out on disciplines, norms, and ethics in your bonded world, you will lose all the charm of the free world as well. Agreed or not? That means the moment you lose out on disciplines and norms at your workplace or at your with your family at home, your club life will be over. And you don't leave your life because of club. You live your life because of a home, family, and office. Yes or no? Club life is dependent upon house life and office life. House and office life is not dependent upon club life. There are a few thousands in clubs. There are thousands of people without clubs and enjoying a life. So, principally, you enjoy your free world because you are bonded with disciplines in your bonded world. Free life is quantity. It fills you. Bonded life, disciplined life, upon which entirely your free world is dependent, is quality, which fulfills you. Agree with me or not? This is a fact. The moment you lose out on disciplines in your bonded world, you will lose out your free world as well. Even if the name of your company is Satyam, you don't have the right to go for asatya practices. Otherwise, it can land you in a 7 years of rigorous imprisonment. The person who used to change three-piece suits three times a day is now in the prisoner's dress. whoever you are. Even if you are Raja or Raju, you can be behind bars if you break disciplines in the bonded world. Quality can, quantity can fill your life with money, with fame, with power. But only quality life, that is acceptance of disciplines, norms, ethics, and developing virtues and living a virtuous life, can fulfill your life. As simple as that. Even if you are the Sahara of thousands of homes, you can still lie be-Sahara in Tihar for 4 years. Even if you are the king of the skies, you have to leave India without an Indian passport. Even if you have by one idea generated in the cricketing world, filled up stadiums all over the world and all over the country, you have to leave India and cannot come back to India. Whoever you are, whatever you are, don't transgress the lines of disciplines. Otherwise, whatever amount of quantity that you have in your life, you will lose out all quantities. Ye sabko hua na? The amount of quantities they had in life, money, power, fame, popularities, people running to them, they all had this in life, all became zero overnight. Just because they lost out on qualities in life. They lost out on qualities in life. So your joy, your entertainment, your relationships, your fame, your money, your power, everything is quantity. Napoleon Bonaparte writes in his autobiography, only 7 characters in history, they have the great written behind their names. One of them is Napoleon Bonaparte. India has 2, Ashok the Great and Akbar the Great. Napoleon writes that I can have the world at my feet. I can buy any luxuries upon this earth and under the sun. Upon this earth and under the sun, I can buy any luxuries of life. But now I'm quoting him not just word to word, but letter to letter. He writes, but I haven't seen 6 happy days in my life. The Mughal king Aurangzeb writes in his autobiography, Sari zindagani fizul gai. The amount of quantities they had in life was Mughal king Aurangzeb. Napoleon Bonaparte, the amount of quantities they had was all of us sitting here today, this morning, all of us plus, 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 still not 1/10 of him. They were emperors. Yet, they would express this in their biographies. So without quality, quantity doesn't stand. Quality is the foundation. Quantity of life can build upon that. Foundation should be made strong. Our Guru Pramukh Swami Maharaj was once asked, the person who created this organization to this level. Recently we were talking about Pramukh Swami Maharaj. This organization, when he became the president of this organization in 1950, and he remained the president of this organization till the last breath of his life, that is 65 years. Which is a world record for any person to be the president of from a smallest NGO to this huge international NGO that we are. Within it, for 45 years, he was even the spiritual head of the organization. And from a handful of devotees to a few institutions, he took this organization to the international level to the extent that we have a permanent seat in the United Nations as an NGO. Our representative sits every Wednesday in the United Nations in the NGO category. Pramukh Swami Maharaj put this organization to this level. And the amount of work that he did in his life, unbelievable. He was once asked by a reporter in the United States, Swamiji, what is the role of religion in society? Samajma dharma no role suche. Dharma ka role kya hai samaj mein? Pramukh Sai Maharaj spontaneously replied. He said, in exact words, again quoting him letter to letter, Pramukh Sai Maharaj said, Dharma to samaj no pran che. It is the soul of the society. And it is. Dharma means righteousness. Dharma means disciplines. Dharma means norms. Dharma means character. It is the soul of the society. In normal prevalence, in normal circumstances, you don't experience this. Once you try to transgress it, and it will show its power. Like a flowing river, at that time, you can't estimate the power of that water. But once you erect a dam, and then the amount of electricity that is produced, then you understand the power of that water. In the same way, in the normal day-to-day routines, you won't understand or experience the power of dharma, that is righteousness in your life, because it's a routine life going on, day-to-day activities. You transgress it, and it will show its power. Ye sabko dikha diya na, powers. King of the skies ko bhi dikha diya, Satyam ko bhi dikha diya, IPL ko bhi dikha diya. You put half neck handkerchief out of your pocket and start your run-up. You being paid 15 lakh rupees per delivery. At the end of the over of 6 balls, you get 90 lakh rupees. Good income, isn't it? But then you face nothing else than a life ban. The gentleman cannot hold the ball again in his life. So in normal circumstances, you won't experience the power of dharma, righteousness. You transgress it, and you will experience it. Until then, your quantity-filled life, you will keep on enjoying, because more relations, more power, more fame, more money, fine, it's good life. But that will work as a catalyst towards you transgressing norms. Actually, if you don't balance your mind, your success becomes a catalyst for failure. If you don't have a balanced, righteous mind. Simple example. For example, you have done your electrical engineering, you did your B.Tech, then you did your M.Tech, you started your job as a junior engineer, then you got promoted as a senior engineer and then an executive engineer, then you became a board member. And for example, you became the chairman of the Maharashtra Electricity Board. After your 35 years, 40 years of experience, you became the chairman of the Maharashtra Electricity Board. My simple question to you is, after becoming the chairman of the Maharashtra Electricity Board and your 40 years of services with electricity, do you have the right to put your finger inside the plug? Give me a clear yes or no. Can you? Can you tell the plug or electricity, see, I'm your chairman, okay? Putting your collars up. Actually, I don't have it. I was just mimicking. You put your collars up and say, okay, I'm your chairman. Your distribution lies in my hands. And I've been playing with you since 40 years. So this is my finger, okay? Take care. And then you put inside the plug. Then what happens? Chipka degi, mar jaoge. Because electricity doesn't know your post, position and power. It knows only human flesh and blood. In the same way, qualities of life doesn't know you as the MD or the chairman of a company, or a senior executive or a board member, or a leading businessman. It only knows human flesh and blood. You have to be very, very careful about it. Otherwise, we can lose on all fronts of life. See, life is all about crest and troughs. And having a binary equation with equal amount of whites and equal amount of blacks is almost unimaginable. But that I also understand. But at the same time, if you want to be a desirable commodity for all at all the times, is the biggest mistake of your life, you are ruining the quality of your life. The biggest mistake of this 21st century is man, he wants to be a desirable person all the times, at all the places, to all the people. That is called commodity living. That is not human living. Are you a commodity that you want to be desirable at all the times? To become desirable at all the times, at all the places, to all the people, you compromise with ideals. You compromise with disciplines and norms, and you compromise with righteousness. Yes or no? This is a mistake. A serious error in life. You are you. You are fine with yourself. You are not offending anybody. You are good with people. Fine, live your life. Go for qualities in life. Quantity will fill you. It doesn't have the power to fulfill you. But we have given too much amount of power to money and fame to rule our lives. And we have rested our life decisions on money. This is too much given to money. It doesn't deserve this much. This is too much given to money. Too much amount of power we have given to money in our lives, which actually does not deserve. You hear the top 10 management gurus of the world, from Ken Blanchard to Ogbandino to Jim Collins to Stephen Covey to Anthony Robbins to Shiv Khera. They are teaching top class executives, scale down, come back, withdraw, introspect, don't keep running. In the 100 meters hurdles where Carl Lewis or Ben Johnson runs or Morris Green runs, is how fast you run. In the run of life, it's not how fast, how steady you run. Running fast is quantity. Running steady is quality. Quality fulfills your life. Because if you stumble there, you will just lose a gold medal. If you stumble here, you will lose a life. Concentrate and focus more on qualities of life. As a human being, what is expected of me from the great seers and seekers of India, from the scriptures, from the life of great personalities, what is expected of me by my family members, by the society, by colleagues at workplaces? You want to identify yourself more as a professional. I did this, 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 and this. We are concentrating less on identifying ourselves more as a human beings. I am this, this, and this. I did is quantity. I am is quality. We want more lists of I did. Isn't it? We want a longer list of I did. Make a longer list of I am. That is quality. And I am list has the power to generate thousands of I did lists. The I am list has the power to generate thousands of I did lists for you. So the first important aspect of quantity fills and quality fulfills is your free life, your entertainment life, your club life is necessary for you, but it is absolutely dependent upon your disciplines and righteousness at your bonded world, that is your house and your office. The moment you lose there, you will lose here also. Because the moment you lose there, people here will start keeping distances with you, even in your free world. The best of the friends who are putting your hands around your shoulders, the moment you go into carefree life in your bonded world, your friends in the carefree world will also start keeping distances from you. Recently, the gentleman, when the Indian cricket team was in England, perhaps in Birmingham somewhere, The man of the skies, he tried to visit the party, and all the 11 players started keeping distance with him. You might have read in the newspapers. So case study number one is righteousness and discipline in your bonded world. That is quality life. With that, with roots firm, with foundations strong, fly with all your energies to the destinations you want. That is, expand your business to the levels that you want. But your roots deep into ground and foundations strong into ground. That is qualities of life. So you never lose out. Case study number two. I want to make a comparable case study between Napoleon Bonaparte and King Janak. Napoleon Bonaparte the Great, Janak was not the great. Napoleon Bonaparte was an emperor. King Janak was a king. Very less known because his name is in the scriptures, so we know him a bit. These millennials will probably not know. Mohan Bhai, this millennial generation will know Napoleon Bonaparte, but not King Janak. અહીંયા બેઠેલા જ અડધા પહેલી વાર નામ સાંભળ્યું હશે હેમલ પહેલી વાર સાંભળ્યું પહેલાં સાંભળેલું ફર્સ્ટ ટાઈમ જો મને ખબર પડી ગઈ આંખ પરથી ખબર પડી ગઈ સાચું બોલ્યું એ મોટી વાત છે મિલેનિયલ જનરેશનનો આ ગુણ છે જસ્ટ લાઇટ મોમેન્ટ્સ અપાર્ટ બટ ફોર ધ વર્ડ નેપોલિયન દેર વોઝ ફિયર ઇન એવરી સોલ ઇન ઇંગ્લેન્ડ वहां से वो कहवत निकली है कि बच्चे जब रात को सोते नहीं थे तब उनकी माँ उनको कहती थी सो जा वरना नेपोलियन आएगा दैट डायलॉग फ्रॉम इन दैट फेमस फिल्म हैज कम फ्रॉम दिस बायोग्राफी आई हैव नॉट सीन इट बट आई गिव यू द हिस्ट्री ऑफ इट नेपोलियन बोनापार्ट ही वॉज द फर्स्ट टू ड्रीम ऑफ अ टनल अंडर द इंग्लिश चैनल ही हैज रिटन हिज ऑटोबायोग्राफी इन 1815 He was the first to dream of it because he wanted to send troops to England through that. King Janak, we don't know any such stories of his life. Now see, difference between quantity attachment and quality detachment. After the war at Waterloo, Napoleon was captured alive and put on St. Helena Port by the British as a captive. He lived the rest of his life there in utter grief. The last word the historians say that he ever spoke upon this earth was the name of his wife, Josephine. He was kept captive on the port of St. Helena, rather the island of St. Helena, away from his wife. The Britishers wanted to torture him emotionally to the maximum. On the other side, when the whole city of King Janak, Mithila, was burning. And King Janak said, in this whole city when it is burning, nothing is mine. I am the king, I have the responsibilities, but as I am attached, I am detached as well. He made all the possible arrangements to douse the fire. But at the same time, with a strong understanding in mind that today it got burned, tomorrow it will be there, I will be burned when I die. Napoleon Bonaparte became a legend. King Janak became a beacon for spirituality. Napoleon Bonaparte entered the books of history. King Janak entered the books of scriptures. Increasing number of teachings from the top management gurus to top executives is the new word coined by Jim Collins is detached attachment. Sankhya Sahit Yoga, jisko bolte hai. Yoga along with Sankhya, that is full attachment to people, to activities, to work with full sense of detachment as well. That can give you physical, mental, emotional health benefits to unimaginable levels. Only attachment is quantity of life. Detached attachment is quality of life. is quality of life. Detached attachment. See what attachment we have and why we have not understood detachment is, for example, money. Money is essential, it is a requirement. But we have made it a status symbol. Essentiality and requirement is quality. Making it a status symbol is quantity. It will fill but not fulfill. For example, you cloth. You need clothes to cover your body. You need clothes to look sober. That's it. But wearing and wanting to wear always branded clothes or branded items on your body is trying to going for quantity in life. You have not understood right. Mark Zuckerberg never wears any branded item on his body. Bill Gates, you see his pictures. In the last 15-20 years, the richest people upon this earth, they have never visited a branded shop. They say, I am what I am when I meet people, when I talk to them, when I relate myself to them, when I work to them. I am not, that is my value, is not enhanced because of the branded things that I wear. Brand your heart, brand your head, not just your body. Branding your body is quantity of life. Branding your heart, soul, and mind is quality of life. People are not known by statuses now. People are known by their character and skills. Do you accept this or not? People are known by that. I suggest a very good book. The title of the book is Massive Life Successes, written by Darius Forox. I just recently stumbled upon that book at a friend's place and I found it very interesting. Half the book I've read. He gives a list. Very clearly in the chapter he states, you are not the bucket list that you have. He uses this word, bucket list. From morning or from the start of our lives, we have the list. I want to do this, 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 do this, do this. Just checking out on that items by evening time. Checking out of the items at the end of the week, at the end of the month, at the end of the year, halfway career. Are you absolutely dependent for your good living on finishing off your bucket list? How many things are really meaningful to you? You are not your bucket list. Your life is outside your bucket list. Second chapter he says, you are not the amount of money that you hold in your bank account. A leading thinker has said, he's also a management guru, that the amount of money that you have in your bank account when you die is the extra work that you did, you shouldn't have done. The amount of money that you have in your bank account when you die is the extra work that you did, you shouldn't have done. You should have found your time for some better activities than that. You are not the bank account that you hold. He writes, you are not the status that you hold. And he writes, you are not the credit cards in your wallet. We have identified our personality with this. This is quantity life. And great personalities who have lived quality life, they lived without this. And yet, quantity people remember these people. The King of England said, I'm afraid to meet the half-naked fakir from India. He was talking of Gandhi. And his staff, EDC, he asked him, sir, why? He said, that half-naked fakir of India, he holds tremendous willpower and self-confidence because of truth and non-violence in his life, the quality of life that he's living. I know he will overpower me in the debate. Winston Churchill, the wartime prime minister of England, who gave us the symbol, the world, the symbol of V for victory. When more than 300 German warplanes were bombarding London and the whole city of London was on fire, Winston Churchill poured in willpower in the citizens of England with this symbol that we will win the world war. He energized people. He put together the spirits of people, the bravery of people. That Winston Churchill, when he used to go in the convocation days of ICS officers, at that time they had this ICS, Indian Civil Services. Those who would pass these exams would come down to India and sit as governors of different regions. We call it the Prant. And the senior most would sit as the governor general in Mumbai here and control the entire Mahabharat till the borders of Afghanistan, Pakistan, Bhutan, this side. Such powerful but young and dynamic, energetic ICS officers, age of 25, 28, and they would become literally kings in India. To them, this brave wartime Prime Minister Winston Churchill used to say that you have absolute powers to do anything that you want in India. Now it's your playfield. But don't do one thing. And they would ask what? Churchill used to tell them, don't talk to Gandhi and Sardar. Rest anything you can do. And they would ask why. And you might have heard the dialogue in the film Gandhi, when that English officer is saying, who is Mr. Gandhi? Then the ADC says, sir, not Gandhi, Gandhi. Gandhi. Sir, not Gandhi. 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 In the third attempt, he got it right. They would ask, who is Mr. Gandhi? Who is Mr. Sardar? This young, smart, dynamic, energetic ICS officers would ask. And Winston Churchill, such a powerful prime minister, he would tell these ICS officers that these two people are so much attached to their mission. At the same time, they are so much detached for time and energy for their spiritual elevation in life. Bodily, they are heavily attached. By means of soul, they are heavily detached. So they have the qualities of truth, qualities of righteousness in their lives, that if you will sit in a meeting with them, in a 10-minute meeting, their willpower is such that they will overpower your conscience. And after 10 minutes, Gandhi or Sardar, if they will throw a blank paper at you on your face and command you to sign, you will sign a blank paper. They will write the script thereafter. These two have these powers. So you do everything and anything that you want in India. Just not do one thing. Don't talk to Gandhi and Sardar. If at all you need to meet them or they ask for an appointment, you ask us in England whether we should meet or not, sending us the complete agenda of the meeting. But don't talk to Gandhi and Sardar. See, a man of values, a man of detached attachment. He did not have attachment to his clothes, to his family, to status. At all, if Gandhi had, nobody was there to stop him from becoming the first Prime Minister of India. It was he who proposed Nehru, and thereafter people accepted Nehru. If he wanted to become, he would have easily become. But he did not. That was called detached attachment. And so Gandhi writes in his autobiography that in the midst of all the activities that I do, the peace that I enjoy in my life is because of my singular faith in God and the values of human life. Detached attachment.